It was on the 19th of November, 1960. I was sitting on the tube reading a newspaper, the Daily Telegraph, when one particular paragraph caught my attention. It related how two Portuguese students had been sentenced to terms of imprisonment for no other offence than having drunk a toast to liberty in a restaurant in Lisbon. This was during the dark days of the Salazar regime. Perhaps because I'm particularly attached to the concept of liberty, perhaps because I'm fond of wine myself, this news item produced a righteous indignation in me that transcended normal bounds. 6 months later, I published an article in The Observer called The Forgotten Prisoners, which was reprinted simultaneously in many of the world's influential papers. As I remember, that article began with these words: "Open your newspaper any day of the week and you will find a report from somewhere in the world of someone being imprisoned, tortured or executed because his opinions are unacceptable to his government." This is where the first office of Amnesty International was set up. The basement room overflowed with material, and upstairs we continued to receive letters from all over the world, letters of support and encouragement. This made it possible for us to think that we could turn the one-year campaign into a continuing international movement.
In that first year, 7 countries joined the new international movement. During the 1960s, Amnesty produced a number of reports on the oppressive prison conditions in different countries. A report on Aden of allegations of brutality by British interrogators caused a furore.
I think that governments are very much like individuals in the sense that they like to be liked. And governments are, I think, increasingly sensitive to international public opinion.
By 1970, there were 27 countries around the world with amnesty groups, and 2,000 prisoners were under adoption. When Amnesty produced a damning report on torture in Brazil, the government banned any mention of the organization in the country's press.
An urgent action appeal brings protest against the death sentences from members all around the world. Amnesty International was to launch a worldwide campaign against torture at the UNESCO building in Paris in 1973. Amnesty's campaign resulted in the United Nations adopting a declaration on torture in 1975.
Inhuman or degrading treatment or punishment. It is so decided.
It was in the 70s that Amnesty received a series of awards for effectively fighting human rights violations.
In 1977 had been declared Prisoners of Conscience Year by Amnesty International. And the award of the prize is a most welcome support for our efforts.
On behalf of Amnesty International, the diploma and the gold medal of the Nobel Peace Prize for 1977.
The honor to present to Amnesty International the 1978 United Nations Human Rights Prize.
Amnesty International, the human rights group, compiled a file of the missing. They listed 2,665 people who disappeared between March 1976 and September 1979.
I am Thomas Hammerberg, Secretary General of Amnesty International. And here in our documentation center, we subscribe to hundreds of newspapers, official bulletins, and transcripts of radio broadcasts. We are constantly looking for reports of arrests, political trials, torture allegations. Everything is systematically recorded, country by country, and then checked and cross-checked.
Over 1 million people signed a petition calling for a universal amnesty which was presented to the Secretary General of the United Nations in 1983.
I want you to know that we at the United Nations are grateful for the work which you are doing with such dedication and skill.
Here in London is the headquarters of one organization which does not forget those in prison, those under torture, and those sentenced to death. Amnesty International is celebrating the 25th birthday this week of its worldwide crusade against injustice.
Amnesty International.
The telex room is Amnesty's nerve center. Here, information on prisoners and torture victims is circulated to the national amnesty sections in 45 countries. Only prisoners who have never advocated violence are adopted as prisoners of conscience, although Amnesty always campaigns against torture and executions.
Our position in Amnesty International is clear. Governments must never combat terror by resorting to terror themselves. Torture, disappearance, and extrajudicial executions are never justified.
In the spring of 1988, Amnesty announced its plans to launch a world music tour.
So I feel it's very important now to call on all the governments of the world to open their arms to us, to help us out.
Celebrating, strangely enough, 30 years of Amnesty International, the world's first and the world's finest human rights organization.
If people collectively or individually take action, they can change the situation. We are asking the citizens of the world to get up and sign up to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and take action to bridge the gap between the principles and the reality.
So, like Amnesty International, you see, their sole sort of aim is helping others.
The campaign Take a Step to Stamp Out Torture has been calling on citizens to declare torture-free zones around the world. Amnesty International also launched its first ever internet campaign and won an award for its innovative website, StopTorture.org.
It is in our hands to build another world.
With this report, we launch our campaign to mark our outrage and to call for urgent action.
Yeah.
Once the concentration camps and hell holes of the world were in darkness. Now they are lit by the light of the amnesty candle. Better light a candle than curse the darkness.